Jesus said, I have many things to say and all truth. We say that spirit of truth is Muhammad. He guided mankind into all truth. All truth means solution to all your problems. So you see, Hazrat Isa alayhi salam had given the news that this one who is coming after me, he will guide you into all truth, meaning solve all your problems. And there are so many problems abounding. In my country, number one, the worst problem is the problem of race, racism. Each and everyone feels that his race is better than the other race. Racial problem. Then in America, you see, I was there in America last October. I was debating with this Christian missionary, Jimmy Swaggart. And this Jimmy Swaggart, he had published a number of books on alcohol and on gambling, on homosexuality, and on and on. He has printed more than 30 different booklets on different aspects, problems. And he speaks about the greatest problem in America, he says, is the problem of alcohol, drunkenness. And he gives a figure in his book. He says there are 11 million drunkards in America. 11 million drunkards, pittaglo. And he says there are 44 million heavy drinkers. And like a good Muslim, he says, I make no difference between the drunkard and the heavy drinker. To me, they are the same, as it will be the same to the Muslim. Whether you drink too much or you drink a little less, you are still breaking Allah's command. Pittak, pittak, pittak. So there are 55 million drunkards in America, according to Jimmy Swaggart. What is the answer? He says in his book, The Preacher, that at a church conference of all the evangelists, preachers, they were trying to get the support from the preachers to say, people who are prepared to speak out against alcohol. And he says, in a few hundred preachers that were there, only a couple were opting for preaching against alcohol. The rest, they reasoned. They said, you see, our Lord Jesus, he turned water into wine at the marriage feast at Cana. If it was good enough for our God, it's good for us. Good logic. If it's good for your God, it's good for you. So as such, he said, look, we can't talk against it. Because Jesus turned water into wine. And they reasoned that that wine was not pure grape juice. Because he says, when at that marriage feast, when people were drinking almost late into the night, and when they ran short, so the mother of Jesus comes to Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, according to the Bible, and says, son, look, these people, you know, they have run short of wine. Do something, help them out of the problem by some miracle, some mojiza. She's expecting her son to turn, do something magical to solve the problem. So Jesus tells his mother, says, woman, that's what the Bible says. Woman, orat, what have I to do with you? What have I to do with thee? My time is not yet. Abhi mera time waqt nahi aaya. And when she persuades him further, he turns water into wine. And since then, wine has flowed like water in Christendom. This is a start. What is the answer? They have no answer. They have no answer. There are good people among them who don't touch alcohol at all. There are good people among them who don't even smoke cigarettes. Yes, again and again, some of them, they put us to shame. They come to our houses, and you find the Muslim fellow, he can't resist, and he must. As soon as he comes out of the masjid, he must pull it out and put it into his mouth. Nicotine, he can't do without nicotine. But there are Christians, you know, those who say they are born again, nai zindagan mein ko hasil hui hai. They don't touch alcohol, they don't dance, they don't go to the cinemas, they don't smoke. At least they show that. Spirit of sacrifice. So Christendom has no answer to alcohol because the Holy Ghost didn't tell them in 2000 years, don't touch alcohol. 2000 baras hue, not one church was told, don't touch alcohol. The answer Allah gives us in the Holy Quran, four evils cut to the root with one ayah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya ayyuhal lazina amanu, so you believe. Iman walo. Ya ayyuhal lazina amanu, innamal khamru, musatli intoxicants, any intoxicant. Wal maisiru, and gambling. Wal ansabu, and fortune telling. Wal azlamu, and idol worship. Rizjun min amal shaitan, are an abomination of Satan's handiwork. Fajtanibuhu la'allakum tuflihun. It's a shun such abomination that you may prosper. And wine barrels were emptied in the streets of Medina, never to be refilled. We can boast, we Muslims can boast, that our is the biggest society of teetotalers in the world, people who don't imbibe alcohol. We have our drunkards, we have. We have a fair share of the good and the bad to be found in every other religious group. But as a people, as a whole, we are a people least consumption of alcohol in the world, Muslims as a people, as a whole. They haven't got an answer. They have a problem of surplus women. There are 7.8 million more women in America than men. And total number of women, unmarried women in America, 20 million women without husbands. But if every man in America got married, which will never happen, every man, every male, gets married, there will still be 7.8 million women left who can't get husbands. In the city of New York alone, there are 1 million more women than men. In one city, city of New York, 1 million more women than men. And of the manpower they have there, in that city, one third are gays. Gays. It's a beautiful word, gay. You know what they mean, Qawmi Lut? Qawmi Lut, Allah destroyed them. For the unnatural lust, Allah destroyed them. They call them gays. Homosexuals, they call them gays. They give a beautiful name. Beautiful word, they prostituted. Beautiful word. You see, when I was at school, in my school days, we were learning poetry, English poetry, and in which I was rhyming, gentle lords and ladies gay, on the mountain dawns the day. Lords and ladies, gay, khush mijaj, jay, joyous and happy and gay. We are always talking happy and gay, he's happy and gay. But today, if you said that our chairman is happy and gay, he's got other meaning. So Allah Bari Ta'ala gives them a whack. He gives them what is called acquired immune deficiency syndrome, sickness. That Allah Bari Ta'ala, when you do that, Allah punishes you. He punishes you with a sickness that makes the body without resistance. Anything comes, any sickness, the body can't fight. Allah Bari Ta'ala has made in this mechanism, every human being, that any outside germ influenced by microbe that gets into the body fights and put things right. Sometimes there's a fever, means the fight is heavy. There's a fever and there's a fever. In other words, the battle is going on until the body overcomes the sickness and the fever goes. This is how Allah made each and every human being. But you indulge in that sin of Qawmi Lut, the sodomites, catamites, Allah strikes them with AIDS. Imagine, AIDS. Beautiful word. Again, prostituted. AIDS. We have Muslim aid, you know. Yes, some of the very few people, there are some 72 Christian agencies working among the Mujahideen, Christian agencies in the guise of medication, social welfare and help. They are trying to Christianize our brethren. 72 agencies are at work and only 9 Muslim bodies, 9. And one of them is called Muslim Aid. you know, as soon as the outside world is Muslim aid, the word, you know, takes you off onto that other field.
Kya baat hai?
What is the solution? 20 million women can't get husbands. One third of the people in New York are gay, sodomites, Qawmi Lut. And the prison population, 98% of the people in prison are males. And man gets cold feet for so many different reasons. You know, he wants to marry, young man. Say, beta, kya, what's wrong? Come, I'll take you. Mr. Dilat ki ladki bahut achi hai. Come, I'll come and show you. Take you. He says, yes, yes, he wants to marry. And you take him there, and something happens before long, where say he gets cold feet. Kuch na kuch bahane phusal jata hai. How many of our young men sitting here not married? Why? Somehow they think they can't make the grade. So, human beings all over, it's the same. You think you might not make the grade. But a woman for anything, says even she is a frigid, she wants a husband. Somebody to give her protection. But man gets cold feet again and again. The problem is getting worse. What is the answer? Allah Bari Ta'ala gives the answer. In this last and final messenger of God, in the Holy Quran, he says, marry women of your choice by twos and threes or fours, but if you cannot do justice between them, marry only one. The only religious book on the face of the earth which has the expression, marry only one, is the Quran. Polygamy was prevalent in the time of Jesus. He never spoke a word against it. Slavery was prevalent in the time of Jesus. He didn't speak one word against it. He left it to somebody else, and that somebody is the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, I have yet. But I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of Truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. We are claiming that Allah Bari Ta'ala has given us solution to all your problems. Bring them, and in the teachings, in the direct teachings of the Quran or the sayings of the Prophet ﷺ, you will have an answer to your problem. It might not go down well. You know, we are used to certain ways of life, certain standards. It might not go down well, but I said, if you do not accept the solutions given here, then you simmer in your soup. You see, the Westerner is always ready to laugh at us. When you meet a Westerner, how many wives have you got? You know, because at the back of the mind, he said, man, you got a harem, harem, you know, so many women in the house. How many? In my case, I said, look, I got only one. I'm married for more than 40 years now, and I'm quite happy, I'm satisfied. I have only one. But this is always a standing joke. How many wives you got? The Arab, how many wives you got? The poor fellow sometimes might not have even one. But he says, how many? how many wives you got? There is a big joke. Because Islam allows polygamy, limited polygamy, up to four. I said, you know, it's an answer to your problem. You don't listen to what Allah is telling you, then you do all the unnatural things. You have your lesbians. Last June, 300,000 sodomites, Qawmi Lut, they call them gays. They gathered in San Francisco, 3 lakh in San Francisco on a pilgrimage, Hajj karne nikle, Hajj, in San Francisco, led by 50 lesbians on motorcycles. But that nation is worried about you and me. He says, you're going to go to hell. They want to save us from hellfire. So they're sending the missionaries at the moment out of the world. 70,000 full-time crusaders, mujahids of Christianity, 60% are Americans. Work it out, 42,000 Americans are raising the dust throughout the world wanting to save you from hellfire. They are in hell themselves. With 55 million drunkards, 20 million women who can't get husbands, absolute hell. I'm telling my Arab brothers jokingly, you know, when I'm there, I keep on telling them jokingly. But sometimes many a serious thing they say, I said in jest, haste haste, hum serious cheek bol dete hain. So I tell the Arabs, I said, look man, you know, you people keep on running to Bombay, running to Beirut, now running to Bangkok. I said, look, go to America. I said, help the poor Americans. Look, in New York, and from the East Coast, New York got 1 million more women than men. They can't get husbands. I said, look, you all bring 4 each. And your country is sparsely populated. Hardly any people in the country. Desert country, no people. I said, man, if you can't propagate Islam, procreate. Bacche paida karo. But nobody is following my advice. You see, my dear brothers, in the teachings of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, and the teaching of Islam, there is a gradual evolution. And in that evolution of the teachings of religion, Islam is the culminating point, the final point. Perfection has been reached in Islam. As Allah says, Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenukum. Says, this day I have perfected for you your religion. Wa Atmamtu Alaykum Ni'mati. And have completed my favors unto you. Wa Raditu Lakum Al-Islama Deena. And have willed that Islam should be your religion. Perfection. Let me give you an example. I said, you see, in the time of Hazrat Musa al-Islam, according to the scriptures, the Jews had a law of divorce. A man can divorce his wife for so many reasons. What he had to do was, like we Muslims are doing now. You know, you say, talak, talak, talak. They said, look, I divorce you. In their language, they must say, talak. Go. So the poor woman, she goes back to her parents' home. And the man changes his mind. He says, no, man, that woman used to work like a donkey. You know, I can't get another worker so cheap. So he goes back to his father-in-law, goes to his father-in-law's house and says, come on, dear, back home. So what for? So what do you mean, what for? She says, you divorced me. He says, no, I told you to go have a little holiday at your father's house. And now you want to get another husband. Come, come. Shh. Catches her by the hair and brings her back. He's going back on his word. So Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, a spiritual physician among the Jews, prophet of God, Allah guides him to give them, to tighten them, so he gives them a law. He says, whosoever puts away his wife, let him give her a bill of divorcement. Talak nama likkar tum de do. Now, to straitjacket the man, you just can't say talak, and then you say, I didn't say talak. Put it down in writing. The Jews, our cousins, are very ingenious people. So they said, right. You see, the law says, whosoever puts away his wife, let him give her a bill of divorcement. Likkar dena hai. That's all. That's the necessary primary requisite is that you give it in writing. So right. So the woman has got half a dozen children now. She's not the same anymore. Soft and flabby. He wants to get something nice and crisp. So she says, look, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam said, give her a bill of divorcement. Likkar de diya. Ja. So, then he gets another one, and he gets her into trouble, and he wants to get rid of her. What does he do? So the law says, put it down into writing. So he puts it down into writing. He's within the law. The law says, likkar do, to likkar dete hain. So Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, another spiritual physician, a prophet of God among the Jews, he sees this abuse. So, he wants to tighten them. So he says, it has been said by them of old time, Quran Jamane mein aage kaha gaya hai, that whosoever puts away his wife, let him give her a bill of divorce. But I say unto you, whosoever puts away his wife, except for the cause of fornication, causes her to commit adultery. And whosoever marries her that is divorced, committed adultery. No divorce whatsoever. And you can't marry a divorced woman. If you marry a divorced woman, your children are illegitimate, according to what Jesus said. Now, he was only prescribing for the sickness of his people. This was not a panacea, a cure-all for eternity. Because he said, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you can't bear it now. There's somebody coming after me who will guide you into all truth, everything that you want to know. But he is now prescribing for the sickness of his people. His people, according to what they say, they said, no, there's no divorce. Divorce is not allowed. But you have divorced by the millions. Divorced by the millions. Millions. The number of illegitimate children. Sicknesses. By the millions. South Africa, my country, is boasting the second highest divorce rate in the world, among the whites of the world. The gallant Danes, the Danish people, the Norwegians, they were beating the South Africans. Now the Americans are beating South Africa. But the second highest divorce rate in the world is South Africa today. And yet, his book says, no divorce. And if any divorced person gets married, he says he's committing adultery. You can't marry at all a divorced woman. So I said, come on now, how many of you, somewhere along the line, because the Bible says, you see, that once you are illegitimate, the Bible language, in the book of Deuteronomy, God is supposed to be saying that the bastard shall not enter the congregation of the Lord even unto the 10th generation. Look, this word bastard is in the Bible, in the King James Version. I'm not using filthy, dirty language. This is the Holy Bible says the bastard shall not enter the congregation of the Haramzada, masjid mein nahi aayega, thus generation. That's what the Bible says. So I'm asking, that means once you are a bastard, your 10 generation are bastards, according to that. So could there a single, I want to know if there is a single Christian who doesn't have that title. One. Look back your 10 generation. According to what it says, I don't know how true that thing is, but the Bible says that once you are a bastard, you are a bastard for 10 generations. This is the generation that you remain a bastard. So who is legitimate? I want to know whether Reagan is or whether Mrs. Thatcher is. Who is legitimate? No. You see, there's something wrong somewhere. Something wrong somewhere. This teaching was a beautiful teaching Hazrat Isa alayhi salam gave for a particular sickness. He's giving it and he's telling you that, look, this is for you, the Jews. This is not for mankind. For you, there's somebody else coming, for the whole of mankind, who will guide you into all truth. And you can carry on divorce. About the laws of retribution. Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, he said, so whosoever strikes you, he said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Beautiful law. A beautiful law for the nomadic people, moving from oasis to oasis in the desert. There was no time for lengthy litigations or putting a man in prison. An adulterer and the adulteress, the Bible says, stone them to death. That's what the Bible says. Stone them to death. There was no time for putting them out of the way. He said, look, you stay in the desert to die of hunger and thirst. It was more merciful to kill them, more merciful, and they become an object lesson for others. Don't you do that. See what happens? You do spoil somebody else's property. See what happens? Mar jayega. Patthar se maar maar ke maar dalega. Shh, not for me. Everybody wants to see that horrible death. He said, no, not for me. It's an object lesson. Beautiful law. So Jesus Christ, you see, he says, it has been said, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, whosoever looketh upon a woman to lust after her, hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. O haram kor ban gaya, just by looking. So, we still have long leg contest, beauty contest, striptease contest. In Christendom, and they think nothing of it. It's nothing of it. They read these beautiful sermons, but reason. The reason is because Jesus said, you see, he said beautiful things, but he didn't have the time to explain. There's no time. That poor man, according to the scriptures, whenever he opened his mouth, the Jews were after his blood. Stoned him, want to kill him, stoned him. And he's running, he's hiding. A man in such a situation, he's got no time to tell you the whole truth. So he says, I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak from himself, but what things shall he hear, that shall he speak. As Allah, our Nabi is made to say, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. He does not speak from his own desire. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْمُ يُوحَىٰ. It is no less than an inspiration sent down to him. عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَىٰ. He is taught by one mighty in power. Then he will testify of me, the Spirit of truth. He will bear witness of me. He will testify of me, talking about me. Who did that? In the history of the Jesus, who testified, bore testimony that Jesus Christ was a true messenger of God, that he was the Messiah, he was born miraculously, his mother was a virtuous woman, she was a saintly woman. He gave life to the dead by God's permission. He healed those born blind and the lepers by God's permission. Who said that? It's our Nabi Kareem, this spirit of truth, this prophet of truth. He testified, and because of him there are 1,000,000,000 Muslims today. Without any kind of convincing, we accept that Hazrat Isa alayhi salam was the Masihullah, he is Rasulullah, he is Ruhullah, he is the word of Kalamullah, he is the word of Allah, and so on and so on. We accept. And he is the greatest benefactor of Jesus, this comforter. He is giving comfort to his mother, comfort to Jesus. Because there is nobody besides. In the Holy Quran, it is something that we should check up, read, study, memorize, and show it to our Christian fellow countrymen. There are people who are working with you. People are working for you. Call them. The people that come along from the outside, you know, the European, talk to him. He says, you know, we believe in Jesus. Of course, at first hand, they are suspicious. They think now maybe you want something from them. You want a curry favor with them. Maybe you want a cigarette. Maybe you want some chocolates from them. What do you want? Why do you say you believe in Jesus? He says, you know what my book says? He says, no. And if you have taken a little trouble to check up in the Quran, like Surah Ali Imran, the birth of Jesus. In this book, in this encyclopedia, the one I'm talking about, by Abdullah Yusuf Ali, in the index you see Jesus. And you see there, first reference, a righteous prophet, Allah ke sachche Nabi, chapter 6, verse 85. Number 2, second reference, his birth, Padaish Kabayan, chapter 3, verses 42 onwards, chapter 19, verses 23 onwards. Take a little trouble, check up these verses, memorize them, like for example, verse 42. So, وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. So, behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَطَحَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ. That God Almighty has chosen thee, purified thee, chosen thee above the women of all nations. Nations. Tell them, this is what my book says. And when I'm talking, this is Islam. Islam is making me to say that. This is not Christianity. I'm not talking Christianity. This is Islam, that he gave life to the dead by Allah's permission, is in the Quran. That he is the word which Allah bestowed upon Mary, is in the Quran. This is my book, I'm talking about my book, I'm talking about my deen. But when I'm giving reference to it, look at this man, where did this man get it? He says, Maryam alayhi salam was a woman chosen above the women of all nations. I'm asking, why would an Arab go out of his way to tell other Arabs that a Jewess, the mother of Jesus, she was chosen above the women of all nations? Why would he do a thing like that? Provoking his own people. When the Jews were looking down upon the Arabs for 3,000 years, they made insinuations that, you know, Ismail alayhi salam and his children are illegitimate. They said Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam had a wife, Sarah was his legitimate wife. And then he took to himself a bond woman, a slave woman, a laundry. Bibi Hajra. She was actually a princess of Egypt. But the Christians and the Jews say that she was a bond woman, londiti londi. And as such, her children are worthless, rubbish, illegitimate. They call them Hagarines. The Jews and the Christians call the Bani Ismail Hagarines. And they call Islam Hagarism. The religion followed by the children of Hagar, Hajar, Bibi Hajar. They say Hagar. And they are still looking down upon the Arab brothers, the cousins, who the Jews. And yet this Arab is made to say that Maryam alayhi salam, the mother of Jesus, she was chosen above the women of all nations. I say, account for that. Account for that. Was he mad? They said, no. He was a mighty genius. There are people and people from different angles. They say, Muhammad was the greatest man that ever lived. The most influential man in history, says Michael H. Hart. The greatest leader of all times, says Jules Masterman. And on and on. You see what the enemies have to say. Lamartine, he said, the greatest man that ever lived is Muhammad. And this man is making 1,000,000,000 Muslims today to accept Jesus Christ as one of the mightiest messengers of God. If he is not the comforter. What is difficult for you to accept about this man? What is it? this book of his, this book of authority, this Burhan, the Christian Burhan, the Bible, it gives them a test. In the first epistle of John, chapter 4, verse 1, to find out whether the man is a man of God or not, they have the test in their own book. First epistle of John, chapter 4, verse 1, it says, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. A false prophet is a false spirit, a true prophet is a true spirit." That is the language of the Bible. How do we know the true from the false? He says, "The spirit that confesseth that Jesus is the Christ is of God." Jo Nabi kahega ki Hazrat Isa alayhi salam is Masih, he is from God, says the Bible. What does he say? What does our Nabi Kareem say? He is made to say. Again, chapter 3, verse number 45. So, وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. So, behold, the angel said, "O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُبَشِّرُكِ بِكَلِمَةٍ مِّنْهُ." That Allah gives you glad tidings of a word from Him. إِسْمُهُ الْمَسِيحِ. His name will be the Messiah, Masih, translated Christ. إِسْمُهُ الْمَسِيحِ وَعِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَا. Jesus, the son of Mary, wajihan fi dunya wal akhirah, held in honor in this world and in the hereafter. Wa min al muqarrabin, and of the company of those nearest to God. Wa yukallimu an-nasa, and he will speak with the people. Fil mahdi wa kahlan, in childhood and in maturity. Wa min as-salihin, and he shall be of the company of the righteous. Testification that Isa is Masih. He is the word which Allah gave upon Mary. This is Islam I'm talking. Brothers, I'm not talking Christianity. This is Islam. But this part of Islam, for 1,000 years, we don't touch it. We read it all right, alhamdulillah. But we don't expound it. Look at this. Come, call them, show them, give them our teas, samosas, bhajiyas. Khilao unko. Aur usko batao ke dekho kya hai. If you can't read it off from your head, open the book. You have a translation. Open the book. Chapter 3, verse 42. Ke tum padho. Read it. But if you can read it in Arabic, and if you can give the translation, there are good people among them, sincere people, you find tears well up in their eyes. And Allah describes them as people who are faith. Even among the Jews and the Christians, there are people, good people. Allah says, "Minhumul mu'minuna," inke andar mu'min log hai, mu'min. Among the Jews and the Christians. Wa aksaruhumul fasiqun, but the majority of them are perverted transgressors, fasiq log hai. But there are good people among them. So what we do, we have to approach them, show them. We assume that each and every one is good. If he is a rebellious transgressor, if he wants to put up a fight, then there are other means of dealing with him. And for that, a booklet has been given to you all. A booklet. Is the Bible God's word? Now that deals with the fasiq people, how to deal with them. The other one, the good man, you assume everyone is good, open the book. Give them your tea, samosas, your curry and rice. Wallah, it can do the job. Your curry and rice. And the Pakistani khana hai. You know, everybody gets enslaved to it. Allah ne usme koi dala hai uske andar. So we have acquired it.